And we do not take out the fire extinguishers. You know, the many, many stuff that was left behind. Chairs that we bought and paid for, 10 cents on a dollar. Big Sixon and I were negotiating with the Americans, Tom Hubbard, along with Admiral, what's his name, of the Philippine Navy. And the Navy would get military stuff, and we just put size there, GOP for the Philippines, or AFP, if I'm not mistaken. And we made sure that we kept those, and that gave us a lot of opportunity to invite folks who come in and have furniture already inside the buildings, and that was another incentive for them to come in. The buildings were not robbed, the equipment was still there, the air conditioning was still running, and so there was a quick start. You have to thank many of the people. I hope you don't mind if I go down there, because I don't like walking from up there and looking down without being able to look at your eyes. Let me tell you that that was the biggest struggle of all. To be able to win against ourselves from the temptation of bringing stuff up. And nobody, I know nobody that took anything out. There was one time, however, something bad happened when we lost some microscopes at George Dewey High School. And I don't know if anybody remembers, I really ran amok. I had to throw Jim Robertson against the wall, because when we caught the perpetrator, I was really about to strangle him. And as I said, do you know what you're doing? Thousands of people go in and out, and they don't take anything out, and you dare take something out, and you're going to ruin the reputation that we have worked hard to establish. Well, we got very upset, and we conducted raids in Kabalan at that time, and when we got back, we got more microscopes than were stolen. I think some of them came from Parkfield. But, you know, these are just some of the things that I remember about that terror. I remember being afraid. I remember being afraid that, you know, as the Hollywood left, and they were playing, you know, "It's Great to Be an American," as they left. And they even made a special public speaker announcement that say, "Mayor Gordon, we will never forget you and your family for all the help your family extend to the U.S. Navy." And you know, that was great, but when I went to the barracks, the BOQ that was left behind, I remember being very upset because they threw away all the keys. They locked all the doors, and we had to pick up the keys and open the door one by one. Went to some halls, and they said, "Now you may steal it, graffiti out there." And immediately, we painted over it. Because I didn't want our people to be embittered by it, although I was quite frankly embittered. I remember when we were in Washington, I had to go to Washington negotiating with the World Bank. I remember I went to the State Department, and I'm sure Inky and Babe Simpson remembers this. I was begging practically that the Americans leave the bowling lanes. I think they had about 18 bowling lanes, 22 bowling lanes. And they were stripping them out. And I said, "Please, don't take out the bowling lanes so we can have a good start, at least for tourism." I remember buying the horses at that cabaret. And you know, the mocking look at the captain, I will not mention his name because he got court-martialed later on. I said, "Can you afford it?" I remember telling Lisa, "Go to all my theaters outside, get the money, and bring the cashier, and put it on the table before this guy." I remember later on, that same captain would take out all the stirrups, all the saddles, and put it on a ship, and leave us with horses that had nothing in them. And I had to call Admiral Mercer, and they had to stop the ship to return all the stirrups. Well, there was a lot of pain, a lot of temptation, but we prevailed over that. And somehow, the Almighty always protected us from anger and made sure that we conquered our fears. I remember going around at night, especially in the cold of night, and I remember huddled women with blankets over their heads because it was cold. I remember I would take my car, the public speaker, and I'd yell, "Volunteers, Sandiabayo, are you there?" And from the dark, you'd hear all the voices say, "We're here, dito po kami." And I would say loudly in my voice, and it would break in the middle because I would be filled with emotion, and I would say, "The country is proud of you." And I'd hear, "Hey, hey," from everyone. I remember when I opened up the duty-free shops, I think it was Duane who negotiated the duty-free shop. There was Teddy De Rosario, and they promised, I said, a lot of people are worried that I made a promise that I can't keep, that we would have duty-free shopping here. See, the vision was to make this a little Hong Kong. Don't go to Hong Kong, you can shop here. Bring your money here so that it stays here. Well, I said, my only request is that you open the duty-free shop on December the 23rd. And remember, the 24th, we took over the base. And they said yes. About December 19, they came over and said they were not going to be able to do it. The ship wasn't going to make it. And I said, "I'm sorry. You will break the hearts of many of my people, and I would have to cancel your contract. I will not let you open. But we will do something about it." And so, on December the 23rd, when I went over the V6 annex, a lot of people were there, Nakagulo, Nairiam, and then some even the people who were incredulous, they said, "Don't believe Dick Gordon, he's lying. You're not going to have duty-free shopping here." And they were the first ones with carts, buying Spam, buying corned beef, buying Hershey bars and everything like that, corn puffs. And a lot of people were very happy. They could buy steak and everything like that. And I was very happy, of course. And so I went to Dodo D and, is it Panginiman? Dodo D was the son-in-law of President Aquino. He was the president then, she was the president then. I said, "How did you guys do it? I thought the ship was going to come over." And she said, "Sir, I'll let you in a little secret. We went to cash and carry in Manila and we bought it at a loss. We got all the goods there and brought it here, so your people will be able to shop at duty-free rates." And wow, they did that. But about a week later, 2 weeks later, the ship arrived. I'm sure they got all their money back. And they made a lot of money. I'm happy when people make a lot of money. I don't have any envy. So long as it's done honestly. And a lot of people did do that. I remember the investors, and I'm now on the investor side, and I would say, make sure you get Filipinos here, especially in the area. I'm assuming along the ball, in Alubian, all the people who used to work here, they should get priority. And I wasn't imposing it. I was just saying, if the qualifications are the same, then you give priority to those who are here. But if somebody outside is better, I'm not going to intervene. I'm very consistent. Last night, I blocked passage of a bill that would take out the VAT-free privileges here in Subic Bay and in other freeport zones in the country. And we won last night. And I remember that incident. And I stood up, you know, I sold Subic Bay the war. And I said, you can't change the rules in the middle of the game. That's why we can't get investors. These are the things that made all these things happen today. Sure, there was a lot of disagreements. Getting FedEx, for example. Even the World Bank said, you're not going to have ships in your place for the next 6 years. What was his name again? Do you remember? The guy who said, you're not going to have ships in Subic Bay? John Arnold, that's right, that's his name. And we were in the World Bank. And I said, I'm going to make a liar out of you. And we went back 2 months later. And the first ship here was here. And they found out first that it was Maersk Line, that it was APL. And we had shipping because The key to a free port was shipping. You can't, just because you have an airport or a seaport, you think you're going to have ships coming in here? No way. There is cost and efficiency and speed. And you've got to have the factory background. And that's why we want to make this a free port, because we wanted this to be the Baksakan or the transshipment point that they can rival Hong Kong. And we got it done. So we went to work back, I think about 2 or 3 months later, they served wine, cheese, and grapes. And he said, Mr. Chairman, we're ready to eat crow anytime you're ready to serve. Just tell you what they said to Trump. Washington Post said to the Trump. Oh, there are a lot of good things. I remember Brian Bussum. He told me, you know, Dick, he said, that flagpole he put up there, the first time move, that's going to break. You make sure you tell Brian, because I've told this story many times. And he said, you know, man, that flagpole is going to break, and that flag is going to be blown away. And I remember he put up my handkerchief, like this. I said, this is my handkerchief. I said, I hope you'll forgive me. This is a little color joke. I said, this is the American platform. It's tall and big. And so I said, see, when I blow into it, it'll go down. This is the little black ball of the Philippines. See, I can hit it and it'll still stand up. Our flag pole will stand up against all the winds and vicissitudes of time. And when I went to Washington, Ronald Reagan Airport, there was Brian Bussum with a big smile, and he's a serving voice, and he said, Mayor, I gotta shake your hand. I didn't think you could do it. And that was the time we went to the Army, the Navy Day in Washington, where all the brass were there. I said, Brian, you're gonna bring me here? He said, I don't want any rival songs about the Philippines. And, you know, naval operations were there, everybody was there, Secretary of the Navy. And we were introduced, this is Dick Gordon, he took over the Civic Bay, and a lot of big hands, you know. And I said,